Right, we are live on YouTube, sir. Great. So, all right, sir. So, can we begin?
Sure.
Good evening, teachers. My name is Varun and I'm the co-founder of Teacher. I warmly welcome you all to the day one of Conclave on Management Strategies for Educators. I'm really excited about today's session as we have with us one of the most firebrand leaders in the higher education space in India, the director of IIM Indore, Dr. Himanshu Rai. While we were working on this conclave, I happened to come across videos of Dr. Himanshu Rai teaching and I was blown away. We are really fortunate to have Dr. Himanshu join us today. Let me take an opportunity to give you a quick introduction of Dr. Himanshu. So Dr. Himanshu Rai is the director of IIM Indore. His core area is human resource management, wherein he focuses on negotiation, mediation, arbitration, strategic human resource management, and leadership. He has been teaching postgraduate and doctoral students since 2006. He frequently conducts training programs for executives and workshops for bureaucrats, IAS, IFS, and foreign diplomats as well around the world. And he has trained over 20,000 professionals. He was the convener of CAC 2010. Dr. Himanshu Rai provides strategic consultancy to the Government of India and in particular has audited programs sponsored by the Planning Commission of India. Hi, Dr. Himanshu. We are honored to have you on Teacher. Thank you so much for agreeing to be a part of this conclave and sharing your thoughts with our educator community.
My pleasure, Varun. It's a pleasure being on your platform.
Great. Thank you so much, sir. So, teachers, I guess we are ready to start the fireside chat. So, Dr. Himanshu, we have asked our educator community about questions that they'd like to ask you. And one of the most common questions was that COVID-19 followed by the lockdown and uncertainty around things has brought in a lot of mental stress and anxiety on both adults and as well as children. Our education system is clearly lacking in imparting mental well-being, mental wellness, and positive psychology. How could teachers inculcate mental strength in their students and teach them on how to face rejection or failures? What is your view on this? How can teachers work on it?
Okay. So, Varun, I'll try and answer it in a way that actually helps both the teachers in addressing their own fears as well as in addressing the fears of the students. Because one of the things we need to understand is that for a physician to heal himself or herself is equally important. So unless the teachers themselves are in a frame where they are mentally resilient, they would not be able to help the students. So let me try and understand and also, of course, explore along with the teachers over here as to what are those things that actually bring about fear. I mean, COVID-19 pandemic obviously is a disease, but let's be very, very clear. This is not the first pandemic, and this is not going to be the last one. And there are several other fears which actually plague people. Now, what has COVID-19 actually put inside, or rather ignited inside everybody? I think the first and the foremost, which everybody fears, and that includes the teachers, that includes the students, is the fear of losing, you know, money and everything that is associated with money, because people are not sure about their jobs. And even if we talk about the younger students, they're not too sure about the jobs of their parents, so on and so forth. So there is this economic activity and there is this economic angle to this entire fear. Now, here, let me try and look at it philosophically. You know, money for a lot of people starts representing their self-esteem and self-worth. But please remember, I'm not trying to put down money, but please remember that money is what money does. It's exactly merely an instrument. So whatever you do with your money is the only worth that money has. And therefore, one of the things that you must understand when it comes to a situation like a COVID-19 pandemic is that we do not require too much to actually live by. We do not require so much to take care of our necessary items in our day-to-day life. For example, in the state of the lockdown, most of the people around the country, around the world, had very limited access to things. They had limited access to food. They had limited access to the variety of food. They had limited access to the material things that they could buy. But people did blip by. And therefore, this entire thing about blatant and unmitigated consumerism, I think that has taken a hit, and we need to actually reflect on that, that we could live by with a lot less than we actually used to spend on. And therefore, we don't need that much money. So that is point one. The second thing, I think, there's a lot of fear and anxiety among the teachers themselves as to what is going to happen to their job, what is going to happen to whatever it is that they do. And here, I want to point out a thing. Never, ever equate your designation with your self-respect or self-worth. Because please remember, the moment you start doing that, you're actually falling into a trap. Why? Because the day the designation goes, so will your sense of self-respect, so will your sense of self-worth. And therefore, if, for example, Varun, you actually introduce me as the director of IIM Indore, if I start associating my sense of self-respect with my designation, then the day my designation goes and I'm going to be a director for only 5 years, that's my tenure. And I've already spent a year and a half, there are only 3.5 years left. So if at all I start associating my designation with my sense of self-respect after 3.5 years, when I cease to be the director of IIM Indore, so will my self-respect go away. So will my sense of self-worth go away. And therefore, to all of you, I implore that figure out what is your true identity. And your true identity and your sense of self-respect should come from what you draw your passion from. So for example, if you ask me, Varun, who are you? I'll say I'm a teacher. Or I'll say I'm a mountaineer, because these are the two things from where I derive my passion from. So I would like to request all the teachers, please remember, you are a teacher, whether you stay in a job in a particular school or in a particular institution of higher education or another, or you actually do private tuitions, it does not really matter. You're a teacher. And by virtue of being a teacher, you will always be a leader, because people, especially the students, are going to live up to you. They're going to look up to you. They're going to try and live according to the ideals that they see in you. And therefore, you have a far bigger responsibility. And thus, the first thing I tell you, if you want to help your students, you need to help yourself. You need to make sure that your actions, your words, your deeds are in line with the person who has a lot of courage. The second area where this fear comes from, I think, is the fear of failure. People are not too sure if they're going to be able to handle this COVID. People are not too sure if they're going to be able to handle the new challenges that COVID throws up, because it's not just about the pandemic. Because of the pandemic, our education has gone online, and it's likely to stay online for at least a couple of months. Teachers are not too sure if they're going to be as effective when they're online. Students are not too sure if they're going to have the same kind of a learning with the same efficiency and with the same efficacy when it comes to this online mode. Now, please remember, failure is a part of life. If you make 10 decisions, if you do 10 things, you're likely to fail in one or two things, because that is what being human is all about. And therefore, you must remember that failure is something that you need to learn from. Failure is something that should pave the way for you to walk onto another path from where you will eventually reach success. And therefore, don't take failure as something of a finality. Failure is never fatal. And even if failure was fatal, it's better to die once rather than dying every day saying, oh my God, I couldn't do this today, die. Oh my God, I couldn't do that today, die, so on and so forth. No, we human beings are meant to be resilient. We human beings are meant to actually help each other and then continue with as a species. So that is the second element. The third element that I see, so far as COVID is concerned and the uncertainty and the mental health issues are concerned, is this element of unknown. Because there is something very unknown, and you know, I'm not too sure, maybe there is something unknowable about this entire pandemic, because we are still trying to break our heads and scratch our heads and see as to what does it do. We still have conflicting opinion about whether it's propagated only through droplets or whether it's an airborne disease. I'm sure that you have read in the last 2-3 days There have been some scientists which are trying to argue that it is perhaps airborne as well. We still don't know whether in India we have had community infection or not, because once again, we have conflicting viewpoints. Now here, allow me to suggest to you a thing. Any time in your life, when you're faced with things unknown, known, unknowable, divide them into two parts. One is the areas of influence, which means these are the things that you can actually do something about. The second is area of concern. And those are the things where you can't do anything. They're not in your hands. And therefore, don't break your head thinking about the areas of concern. For example, whether COVID is airborne or in terms of droplets is not something which is in your hand. What is in your hand? In your hand is the ability to actually do something proactively, which means every time you go out, make sure you wear a mask. Every time you go out, make sure that you have a physical distancing of 6 feet. Every time you go out, make sure that you tell others, that you counsel others who are not wearing masks to actually do so. Make sure that you tell your students. Make sure that you look after those people who are more vulnerable to diseases. Make sure that you're doing something for the disadvantaged sections of societies who do not have the little nest egg that you and I may be able to have in terms of some money put away in the bank. And likewise, for all the students, make sure that you are studying hard. Make sure that you are keeping yourself physically fit. Make sure that you're actually looking after immunity, your immunity. Make sure that you're not procrastinating. So if you take care of the things which are within your hands, which is what I call the area of influence, you will not be bothered so much about things which are your areas of concern. So I think these three points essentially are going to be useful both for the teachers and for their students to build a kind of a mental resilience which we require in today's times.
Right, right. That's a fantastic suggestion, sir. Thank you so much. Moving to the next question that teachers have posed. India is actually known as the spiritual capital of the world. The roots of spiritual education go back to even the Vedic period. However, spiritual education in India has been losing its importance over the years. What is your take on this? How can teachers make use of spiritual education in teaching? How can teachers inculcate spiritualism in students? And in what way would spiritual education help the students?
Now, this is an interesting question, Varun, because one of the things that I did after coming to IIM Indore was to create something called a spiritual garden. And this spiritual garden actually provides space for the entire IIM Indore community to sit, to reflect, and to introspect. And many people had asked me at that time, what is your idea behind this spiritual garden? And my thing was that the place that I converted to spiritual garden was actually a garbage dump. Oh. And I don't like seeing garbage dumps. And I said, wherever we have something which is not being utilized, we are either going to greenify it or we are going to create spaces that provide value add to the community members. And therefore, the entire idea of having a spiritual garden with a water fountain was to help people meditate, was to help people reflect. And of course, one can actually reflect and introspect anywhere. But then it's the same reason why you build places of worship. The reason why you build places of worship is because you say, hey, here is something which is designated. And once you sit here, you get completely different kinds of vibrations. And likewise, a spiritual garden. Likewise, the reason why we create, let's say, a campus itself with the kind of facilities that we create, we can have education in a bunch of rooms. We don't have to really create a campus. The moment you have a designated place, I think that has an impact on the people. Now, coming to spirituality, the first thing is that I think we have lost somewhere the meaning of spirituality itself with the advent of a lot of spiritual gurus. And I'm not here to point fingers at anyone or anybody's the principles they espouse or the principles that they teach. But the whole point is, sometimes I think in the mad quest of spirituality, the spirituality itself is getting lost, which means we are trying so hard to be spiritual that we have actually forgotten what spirituality was. And it's amazing that you point out at the Vedic period, you know, if you look at the word spirituality, it comes from the Sanskrit word adhyatma. And adhyatma means adhi atma, atma dwara jo adhikrit kiya gaya ho, meaning that something which is allowed by atma. Now, the word atma has four meanings in itself. If you look at the Sanskrit root, The word Atma can mean self. The word Atma can mean soul. The word Atma can mean God. And the word Atma can mean conscience. Now you have to choose. I don't like being normative when it comes to spirituality. So you have to choose as to what does Atma mean to you. So for some people, Atma may be God, and they might be saying that whatever is the God's word, doing that is spirituality. By all means, please do so, so long as you know clearly as to what the God's word is. Some people might say soul, and therefore they might get into some kind of a transcendental spiritualism where they would say that I would like to listen to my inner voice. For some people, it may be self. So whatever is good for me is what I'm going to do. So long as you don't harm others, I'm okay with that definition as well. To me, the word Atma in this context means conscience. And therefore, I would say that something which is allowed by your conscience is what spirituality is all about. And therefore, if you look at the Vedic definition of spirituality, it says spirituality is the development of your conscience by understanding your own self, the universe around you, and your relationship with that universe. And by virtue of understanding your relationship with that universe, you also understand your obligations towards that particular universe. And therefore, if we go by this definition, I think what we need to do as teachers is provide a platform, provide courses, provide spaces for students to understand who they are, what is their real purpose in life, what is the universe that they actually associate with, and how are they related to this particular universe. For example, this entire environment, we don't teach students at a young age even about civic duties. We don't teach students about what their fundamental duties are. We teach them about fundamental rights and we spend a lot of time, but fundamental duties are given a go by. Likewise, civic duties, simple things like following traffic rules, like making sure that the way you sneeze or cough, for example, today in this pandemic, we are saying that you should cover your face while sneezing or coughing, that you must wash your hands before you come to eat. You must wash your hands before you go out. You must wash your hands and feet whenever you came into the house. All of this was a part of our system. And, you know, I don't want to get into the details, Varun, but even simple things, if you look at, or at least most of our parents, if you look at even the kind of houses that they lived in, my grandparents and all, for example, a very simple thing, the toilet was almost always created outside the house. It was not a part of inside the house. It was not a part of the main structure. And now, when you look at the effect of this pandemic, suddenly we are going back to all of that. We are saying, okay, wash hands frequently. Make sure that you maintain this. Make sure that you maintain cleanliness. Make sure that you maintain hygiene. Make sure that you cough this way. Make sure that you sneeze this way, so on and so forth. And therefore, for me, I think if at all as a teacher, you could tell your students, you could help your students in identifying their own potential, in identifying their larger purpose in life, in actually appreciating nature, in actually taking care of the environment, I think you have made them spiritual. Spirituality is not about, as I said, you believe in a God, you want to worship God, great. But to me, that's not spirituality. Because if I say that you necessarily need to believe in a God to be spiritual, we are saying that the entire atheist population in this world is not spiritual, which to me is a little bizarre. And therefore, spirituality, to me, is your connection with the universe, is your connection with the universe, and by virtue of that connection, also understanding your rights, your responsibilities, and your obligations towards that universe. So in a nutshell, and this is a message I would like to give to everyone, if you can leave your surroundings cleaner than you found them, and if you can leave people happier than you found them, I think you're a spiritual person.
That's a wonderful definition, sir. I would definitely personally incorporate it, I would say. And moving to the next question, there is a question from the teachers that is about the current learning system. So adding to all the questions, while the 21st century learners are smarter in the use of technology and are academically smarter, their value system has deteriorated significantly. How can teachers infuse the value system in our youth who are citizens of our proud nation? At a very young age, yeah.
Varun, I'm not too sure if the value system of our students has gone down or if they're losing the value system. I think this is also a generational issue that every generation, every subsequent generation thinks that they have more values, and all older generations, I'm sure that my parents think that my generation is low on values. My grandparents thought that my parents' generation had low values. So this is something which is perpetual and never ending. This will go ad infinitum. We will always consider our previous generation to be antiquated, and we will always consider our successive generation to be low so far as values are concerned. And this is not just limited to generations. This is also limited. This also extends to schools and colleges. So I'm sure every batch thinks that their batch is the most super batch. Their previous batch was too antiquated, and the new batch which is coming in, they are too uddand, too shararti, or not really out there, etc., etc. So I'm not too sure that the value system has gotten eroded. I think they have a different set of values. And, you know, values are not absolute in nature. There are, if you look at values from a philosophical viewpoint, there are two sets of values. You have the instrumental values and you have the terminal value. Terminal value, the end state. What is that end state that you desire as an individual or as a collective? So do you want a prosperous world? Do you want a happy world? Do you want a rich world? Do you want a peaceful world? These could be examples of terminal values. And then you have the instrumental values, and instrumental values are the means that you believe will take you to that end. So your instrumental value could be smart working, your instrumental value could be hard working, your instrumental value could be taking shortcuts. And therefore, each of these are values. Now, a society, which means a particular space and time, may consider some of these values to be higher than others. So I would first of all want to clear this air, that it is not that the value system has eroded, it is simply that they have a different set of values. For example, many a times we say that people in the Western countries don't have a value system. Of course not, they have a value system. It's just that their value system is different from the Occident. It's different from the Eastern value system. It's different from the Indian value system. Even within India, you have, you know, most people make the mistake, and not just foreigners, but even people in India make the mistake of thinking India as having a homogeneous culture. India doesn't have a homogeneous culture. We have a heterogeneous culture. So the kind of a culture that I would have in, say, Kanpur, which was my birthplace, would be very different from the kind of a culture that you would be used to, Varun, in Andhra Pradesh. And even in Kanpur, I come from a family where my father comes from a village in eastern UP, and my mother's family migrated from a village in Afghanistan and Pakistan, and then they migrated to India in 1947. And therefore, India is a microcosm of several cultures. And therefore, I think when we say that the value system is getting eroded, we are being harshly unjust to the new generation. What we can say is that there are certain strands of value systems which should be inculcated. So I'm not talking about those value systems which students will inherit any which way, because they will inherit it from their families, they will inherit it from the community that they belong to, they will inherit it from probably some idiosyncrasies of the state, which obviously represents a culture, a language, and so on and so forth. And all of those will be inherited. Now, as a teacher, what are those values? What are those fundamental values that you need to inculcate? And I think that is where the teachers come in, and the role of teachers as something more than simply imparting lessons, but somebody who should also be building a character comes in. So you need to understand what are the components of character. And by character, I don't mean looking at it from a very narrow, blinkered perspective. I'm talking about character, characteristics of character, like character traits like courage, character traits like doing something for the country, character traits like taking care of people who are needy, character traits of helping each other, character traits of teamwork, character traits of collaborating. So I think these are the value systems that the teachers need to inculcate. And there are two ways of doing it. One is that you continue to train them, you continue to talk about it, and you continue to make them practice. And like they say, that if you practice something for 40 days, it actually becomes a part of your habit. So try to inculcate those habits, both by the Socratic concept. So Socrates said habit plus insight is the way that you can actually build character inside students, which means make them do things. So make them participate in community activities, make them participate in activities where they're taking care of the environment, For example, during the time of the pandemic, I actually appealed to my community at IIM Indore, and we took over a lot of jobs. So we took over the jobs of sitting and looking at the security posts. We took over the job of cleaning the campus itself, jhadu pocha lagana. We took over the job of gardening. We took over the job of cleaning the dog shelter. We also take care of the animals inside the campus. We have a dog shelter. We have more than 100 places where we actually keep bird feed and water for birds, and we make sure that the birds got their water, especially during the drier months. So all of these are habits that need to be inculcated inside the students. And most importantly, I think you build character by your own behavior. So the teachers themselves have to be the role models. They should be seen as doing the things that they actually talk about. So if you're not walking your talk, it'll be very difficult for you to build the character of your students. So for example, if I talk to my students that you need to do this, I should be the first person to do this. So I made sure that I went there on all Sundays and did the cleaning and mopping. I make sure that I go to the dog shelter and take care of the dog babies over there. I make sure that I do everything that I expect others to do. Please remember, you can never be a leader if you are not doing what you expect others to do. And therefore, never ask anybody else to do something that you are not prepared to do yourself. So I think by this combination, habit plus insight, and by playing role models, we can inculcate values inside our students.
Wow, that's very insightful, sir. Thank you so much. The next question is more on the lines of online teaching. Given the current shift to online teaching, the atmosphere in a school setup and the one at home by an online class are on very extreme ends. And as we do know already, communication plays a very key role irrespective of the setup. In online setup, I think it's much more impactful as it gets bigger. So the question here is, how can teachers communicate effectively both in an online setup and an offline setup? And what are some tips and tricks that teachers can use to communicate effectively?
Okay. So to begin with, Varun, we need to understand what communication is. The problem with communication is that everybody thinks that they're born communicators, but we are not. We actually have to learn communication. And therefore, if you look at the word communication itself, it etymologically comes from the Latin root communis, which means to share or to make common. Now, what do you share? So in communication theory, they say that there is a sender and there is a receiver. So the sender has a message in his or her head, and the sender encodes the message. And then by using a medium, that medium could be, if you're in class, that medium could be face to face. If you're online, the medium could be a platform such as Teams that you're using over here. The medium could be an email, the medium could be a notice. But by using a medium, you then send the message to the receiver, who then decodes the message. Now here we have to understand two important things. Communication will happen only, and if only, the receiver has decoded the message exactly as the sender intended it to be, which means that this entire software of encoding and decoding needs to be the same. And thus, we have to be extremely important in understanding this. It is not about the sender. It is all about the receiver, because if the receiver has not received and decoded the message as you intended as a sender, then your communication was not effective at all. Whereas people more often than not do exactly the opposite. They try to build on their strengths. So if I can speak good English, I'll speak to you in such amazing English that every sentence of mine will send you scurrying to the dictionary. Does that really help? No, because nothing is getting decoded. I can speak in Sanskrit as well. That's another language that I love. And if I start speaking to you in Sanskrit for the first 5 minutes, you'll listen to me with a lot of joy and possibly a lot of respect that, wow, what a guy, what a great guy. But after 10 minutes, you'll start scratching your head and say, you know, what a fool. Why? Because nothing is going to get decoded. And therefore, I think the most important thing that the teachers need to understand is it is not about your strength. It is how will it be decoded, which means don't try and replicate the way you teach in class exactly the same way when you are online. Why? Because you're not visible. Even if you're visible on the screen, it may not be very, very clear. Your voice may not be very, very clear. So therefore, identify those components which are actually more conducive to this form of pedagogy. Please remember, online teaching is a completely different pedagogical tool. And therefore, the kind of material that you use over there, the way you teach over there has to be absolutely different. Don't try to use the same material. Don't try to use the same method. Don't try to use the same style that you used in class to stand in front of a camera, be it a camera such as this or be it a big camera, and do exactly the same thing. That is number one. Number two, always be prepared that there are likely to be interruptions because of the technology interruptions or because of something basic like a power failure. And it can happen at both the ends. So always make sure that you have prepared. So for example, if in a class you gave out certain material in 1 hour, please remember in an online mode, it is likely that you will possibly need 90 minutes to give the same material because of these disturbances in between. And the third thing, also remember that it's very difficult for students to keep their eyes fixed on the screen. And therefore, it is very likely that they might be missing out on a few things. So make sure that you have some visual tools as well, or make sure that you record your lecture or whatever it is that you have said, and then you make it available to your students, or have a PowerPoint, which at least has key points, which then you can share if you don't want to share the entire lecture. So I think you'll have to use a combination of this, and also make sure that you have familiarized yourself with the technology. So even though I think, Varun, you and I would have probably done 100-odd webinars such as this, starting right from the time of COVID, I'm not even talking about in our entire lives, yet we decided to meet 5-6 minutes before starting and make sure that we familiarized ourselves with it, we checked the system. Now, as a teacher, it becomes extremely important that you do so as well, and make sure that your students do so as well, so that you don't lose time. If you take care of these 4-5 broad things, I think you're good to go.
Wow. Thank you for answering that. I have a follow-up question here. So when teachers are teaching in the online method, there are certain set of areas of concerns that consistently keep coming up. They are that the emotional connect usually is missing in online teaching, the eye-to-eye contact that teachers usually maintain with their students is missing, and all the human elements are missing while teaching online. So how can teachers create a great virtual experience for their students while teaching online without these human elements?
That's a tough one, because one thing, and I can categorically state that whatever you may do, you cannot replicate an in-class experience in the online mode. So don't even try it, and don't even aim for it, because it's impossible. You cannot create that, because even if you create the smartest of classroom at your end, you will not be able to create a smart studio at the end of the student, where he or she can actually visualize you or look at you exactly the way that you have created at your end. You may be able to create a very smart classroom in your school or the college or the institution, and therefore you may be able to see larger pictures of students, larger videos of students, so on and so forth, but you do not control anything at their end. And it is very unlikely that they will have those sophisticated systems, or even they will have the kind of a bandwidth which is required to create a closer to live experience. What you can do is, in the absence of this, try to build your classroom as smart as possible. And that'll obviously depend on the kind of resources that you have. So if you don't have much resources, for example, what we did was, we at IIM Indore, we shifted from the offline to the online mode within a week. And that was by choosing the appropriate platform. So the first thing that you need to do is choose a platform which does not require much bandwidth, because there are platforms and then there are platforms. So choose a platform purely on the basis of bandwidth that does not require more bandwidth and that gives you additional features. So for example, there is a platform which will give you features like taking a poll, which will give you features like having breakout rooms, which will give you a feature like having a different set of a chat box where the question and answers can happen, so on and so forth. So choose the platform very, very carefully. Second, make sure that the camera that you have, because your system, your desktop or your laptop that you may use in your classroom or wherever it is that you're teaching from, may not have the best webcam. So you may need an additional webcam, which is more clearer. So you can get that. The third thing that you can do is that now you have a lot of tablets which can be actually attached to your laptop, whereby using a stylus, you can actually create pictures, you can actually make things. So therefore, try to use these accessories, and this is the lowest end. The higher end, you can actually go for smart classrooms where you have cameras that follow you as you move. So you can actually move around in your classroom or whatever space that you're occupying. Your blackboard would also be visible, so you can use your blackboard exactly the way that you do. But as I said, you will still not be able to hear the students. You will still not be able to see the students. And at the most, you will be able to see their pictures. But then you can, what you can do is you can request the students to be loud. You can request the students to be dressed exactly the same way that they are when they are in the classroom. And you also dress up exactly the same way. That is one. And two, if you think that you are not visible to the students because of bandwidth issues, sometimes we also tell our students to switch off their videos and keep only their audios on. Then make sure that you are speaking with a lot of inflection in your voice. You are taking care of the tonality of your voice, and through your tone, you are actually trying to express your emotion. So for example, if I make a statement, Varun, I'm going to tell you a funny story, versus Varun, I'm going to tell you a funny story. Now, the way I said funny itself actually conveys the emotion that I'm trying to actually talk about. And therefore, the teachers will have to now start working even on their communication skills in terms of their tonality, in terms of their voice modulation. So if you can do some of these things and get some basic accessories in place, I think you're good to go. But as I said, don't even aim to have a replica of the in-class experience, because it's impossible.
Right. That's very insightful, sir. Thank you so much for that. And coming to another core area of yours, in your 14 years of teaching experience, you must have taught and molded and guided thousands of students over the years. And we are very sure many of them must be at executive level in several top MNCs, many of them as CEOs, successful leaders, and not to forget hundreds of other entrepreneurs. So all these people are driving our economy towards a bright future. And it is definitely a proud moment for a teacher as you. But all this happens at a postgraduate level, right? How can teachers instill leadership skills in children from school age and mold them into successful leaders?
Okay. I think I'll talk about a certain experience of mine and try to answer that question in that particular context. So my story is pretty much like the Three Idiots story. I was born many, many years back on a Christmas morning at 10:50 a.m. And at 10:51 a.m., my dad looked at me and pointed at me and said, "Isko engineer banana hai. I want him to be an engineer." 6 years later, my brother was born at 1:10 a.m. And at 1:11 a.m., my dad looked at him and said, "Isko doctor banana hai." And lo and behold, I'm an engineer and my brother is a doctor. It was many years later that I figured out the purpose of my life, and I decided to shift to academia. So after 8.5 years of working with Tata Steel, post my engineering, I decided to shift to academics and went back to school. And many people said, like, "Are you mad? You won't be able to sit in a classroom because you're so not used to sitting." I was working on the shop floor in Tata Steel, and I was walking all the time. Be that as it may, the moment I realized that this is what the true purpose of my life was, nothing else mattered. What mattered to me was that starting today, I will at least start living my dreams. So I think the one thing that teachers can inculcate inside students at the school level is to actually help them in dreaming and not curbing their dreams, not stopping them from dreaming, letting their imagination flow. Because please remember, imagination is far more important than education. So as teachers, you must actually fuel their imagination. You should let their imagination run riot, and then you should try and give some kind of a pathway, give some kind of a direction to their imagination. So I think this is the biggest thing that you can do. The second thing, we actually do not encourage students at a young age to introspect, because somewhere we say that introspection and reflection is something that the wise old people do. No, you become wise only if you have introspected as a child. Otherwise, you just become old. You don't become wise. And therefore, I think another thing that the teachers should do is help their students understand as to what they are and what their responsibilities are through introspection and through reflection, which means engage them in conversations. And don't make education very normative, because this is one of the things. Of course, there are some things where you have to be normative. For example, if you say, "Don't spit," or "Don't sneeze with your into somebody's face," or or don't litter. These are normative things. But when it comes to certain areas where, for example, what is spirituality? We were dealing with this particular question. And what is a good value? Why should you help others? Now, these are normative things where students need an answer. Why? Because at the one hand, you are also driving into them the spirit of competitiveness by saying, oh, you are number one, you're rank two, you're rank three, therefore you get an award, and therefore you are asking them to be competitive. And at the same time, you want them to have a collaborative spirit. And therefore, you need to help them understand through reflection, through introspection, and through dialogue and debate as to why these two things go hand in hand. And likewise, I think another role that the teachers have to play. See, within a school, a child stays for about 5 to 6 hours. And an equal amount of time, the child spends with the parents. So I think the teachers also need to have a larger and a broader engagement with the parents, not just for the Parent Teachers Association meeting, which happens once in 6 months, but on a continual basis, actually taking feedback from the parents and also trying to understand as to what is the kind of an environment that the child gets so far as the home is concerned, and if need be, even counseling the parents. So I think by adopting this holistic attitude, where you're constantly engaging with the child, where you're helping the child explore, and you're constantly engaging with the parents, you can build and inculcate leadership skills inside them right from the childhood.
Right. Absolutely, sir. That was very well said. So for the next 15 minutes, we'll be taking up questions from the live audience on YouTube, and I would be reading them out to you, and you can answer them. So there's a question from Mr. Furkan Asif. It says, is it a good idea to record the entire lecture and send it to students rather than having an online session? What do you think is more valuable to the entire outcome?
Varun, I would say both. For the simple reason that if you look at the asynchronous courses, so you have Coursera, you have Harvard, you have a lot of business schools which have come up with the asynchronous courses, which means that you can do those courses at your will. So that is on your desktop, you can actually download the material, or if not download, you can stream the material, but you can actually access it at any point. The completion rate of all such certifications, of all such courses, is abysmally low. You see, why do you need a classroom? Why do you have fixed hours? Because it brings into you a certain amount of discipline. Why do you think work from home does not work as effectively as it should? Because that discipline element is lacking. And irrespective of how much you try, after a while, you tend to relax, you tend to slack, and lethargy takes over. And therefore, online is always a good idea. The reason why you should record your lectures and give it, or the reason why I said you may probably have PowerPoint if you're not very comfortable recording your lectures, is because there is an asymmetry in terms of the equipment available at the end of the learners. So the students may not, so if a student, for example, has a power outage while you had a synchronous lesson, then the student has absolutely no access to the lesson. And therefore, for such students who have power outages or who may not have a good bandwidth, or they are living in areas which are rural or areas where the internet has not penetrated the way it should have or is yet to penetrate, or areas which, sometimes there is a flood, sometimes there is a cyclone, so on and so forth. So for those students, you need to have something which can be delivered to them in the asynchronous mode. And I understand that there are intellectual property right issues over there. You don't know if a student is going to actually upload your material somewhere, and you may not be comfortable with it. In that case, what you can do is you can have a learning management system which will allow a student to stream but not download the lecture. And that's not too difficult. And many of these learning management systems are actually free. So for example, you can look at something like a Moodle, M-O-O-D-L-E, or a system called Blackboard, which is a free open source learning management system, which will allow you to put material without allowing the participants to actually download it, but they can only stream it.
Right. Wow, that's very interesting. There's a question from Mr. Srinivas Rajula. It reads out, corporate life is much rewarding and promising. How did you leave that and settle as an educator?
I think my academic life is equally rewarding and far more satisfying. The reason, so obviously he's asking me for my story. So there were two, three reasons. One was, as I said, that I figured out the purpose of my life, and that happened in the Himalayas. So I'm a trained mountaineer, and I was extremely fortunate to be trained by Bachendri Pal, the first Indian woman to climb Everest. And I've been mountaineering for the past 28 years now. And I still remember I was sitting in the Himalayas. I had done a peak, and I was sitting there and reflecting. Then suddenly I had this Buddha moment without the Bodhi tree. And I figured out the purpose of my life, and I came down, and I knew what to do. Now, I could have accomplished the purpose of my life even while staying in the corporate world. The only thing is that I realized that the academic world, which means this profession of teaching, will actually take me there faster. And therefore, I made this switch from the corporate life to the teaching life. Now, if you ask me, was I happy in my corporate life? The answer is yes. Because I was working with one of the greatest companies, and I still call it my company, Tata Steel. And Tatas are an amazing group to work with because they allow you to do other things as well besides making steel. So I did make steel at that point of time, but I also did a lot of other things. I conducted about 100 odd quizzes across the country. I directed and produced and acted in half a dozen plays. I also directed and produced an opera. I directed and produced two documentary films, and all of this on Tata Steel's time. And they were the ones who actually encouraged all of this in me. So it was a great company. But the whole point is that you may have a sense of achievement when you do those things, but you don't get a sense of fulfillment. And academic life, teaching, gives me that sense of fulfillment. The moment you stop looking at achievement and you start looking at fulfillment, I think you will always figure out as to what is it that you wanted to do with your life. So you will never see too many smiles on my face while I was on the shop floor. You will not see many smiles on my face if I'm sitting there and being the director of IIM Indore. But you will always see me smiling whenever I'm taking a class. You will always see me smiling whenever I'm in the Himalayas. And I don't need a reason beyond that. The fact that I'm in a class talking to students, teaching them and learning in that process, or the fact that I'm in the Himalayas, I call them my Himalayas, introspecting and reflecting, they give me a sense of fulfillment. So to me, it was not even something that I needed to break my head on. The moment I figured out that this was my purpose, it was simply a matter. So I wrote CAT and I resigned even without waiting for the results of CAT. And my parents were like, they were mad at me. And my friends were also completely cheesed off at me saying, you know, are you mad? You should have at least waited for the results. And I said, no, because I figured out what is it that I want. I don't want to spend a single minute in not doing whatever it is that I want. I mean, that's another story that I was extremely fortunate that I got through and went and did my studies at IIM Ahmedabad. But coming back to the question again, fulfillment is what matters, not achievement.
Very interesting, sir. And you're a very multifaceted individual as well. I'm getting to know a lot about you during this entire course. So there's a question from Tongle Govind, sir. It reads out something like, what about socialization and inclusivity in classes? Usually what happens in a class is that a teacher cannot, in an offline class, a teacher can concentrate on student who's not doing well in studies. But during online, it's very difficult to really reach out to that individual student or reach out to the multiple set of students and maintain that quality of interaction. So how can a teacher actually solve this problem, according to you?
You see, Varun, it's not a problem merely in the online system. It's a problem even in your physical classroom, because you have learners who have, first of all, different capabilities. So even though we get all our students, say, through CAT, which is a very standardized exam, but even though they may be good at solving a certain kind of what the CAT question paper is, their ability to learn and the way they learn are very, very different. Now, whenever we teach in a classroom, we use certain standardized methods of teaching. But what I would suggest is that you must use, as a teacher, multiple methods of teaching and multiple methods of assessment. So, for example, don't teach merely by a lecture, because some students may actually learn more by lecture, but there are some students who may like to learn by storytelling. There are some students who may like to learn through a case discussion. There are some students who may like learning by watching a film or a part of a film or by listening to a song. So figure out how can you impart whatever it is that you are trying to give to the students in the best possible way. And one of the simpler ways of doing this is always divide the component of learning into three components, which is knowledge, skills, and attitude. Figure out what is the best way to communicate knowledge, what is the best way to communicate skills, and what is the best way to communicate attitude. And by communicating here, I mean helping people understand and get it. So how do you make sure that the knowledge has been gained by students? How do you make sure that the skill has been understood and honed by the student? And how do you ensure that the attitude has actually been imbibed by the student? Use different pedagogical tools to actually teach and train students in these three components. Likewise, when it comes to assessment, please understand that not everybody is actually amenable to a particular kind of assessment. So make sure that even your assessment tools are multiple and multifaceted. So there could be a written exam, there could be a Viva, you could write a blog and ask them to comment on that particular blog. You can ask them to speak in the class and then make sure that you actually mark them on class participation. You can give them group assignments. You can give them individual assignments. You can give them take-home exams, which require a lot of research, etc. So by using multifaceted pedagogical tools and multifaceted ways of methods of assessment, I think you can reach out to most of the students. And yet, there may be students with completely special learning needs. You must identify such students and ensure that your class is more inclusive.
Right. That's a wonderful suggestion, sir. That's an absolutely brilliant suggestion. So there's a question from Miss Charlotte Rose Mary Vijaya. It reads out something like, how will you value the performance of students through online teaching that you have already covered? But how can the students who do not have access, who do not have access to internet facilities in rural areas be taught through online platforms? And this is a big challenge for many teachers in our community as well. They are really finding it difficult to reach out to students who do not have access to smartphones, and their entire period of learning is getting destroyed because of this inaccessibility. So what can teachers possibly do to solve these issues?
See, two, three things can be done even here. I understand that if there is no smartphone, then you can't even send lectures. You can't even send, lectures on WhatsApp if the person does not have a smartphone. But I think most of the country now at least has access to television. So the one thing that you will find is that the MHR, the Ministry of Human Resource Development, has actually put a lot of material which can actually be accessed through television. So find out whatever there is. In fact, if you speak to the people in the CBSC, they will tell you. If you speak to the Ministry of the state ministries of higher education or secondary education or primary education, they will talk to you about whatever is available. And then you go to the government website, and you will see that there are several things where classes are available through television. So that is one. The second thing is, you can also start something like, I'm not an expert in it, but since I happen to be an engineer, and that to an electrical engineer, you can also start something on the terms of community radio. Radio does have access everywhere. So you can actually start a community radio where through radio, you impart audio lessons, at least. So I think if you use television and radio, you will be able to impart certain lessons, and thereafter make sure that you get the material, the reading material available to the students. So for example, the student may not have a smartphone to actually download something, but if I can convert my lesson into, say, a 1 hour lesson into a 15 minute audio visual thing, at least that audio visual thing can be sent to the student through a pen drive or some such thing. At the end of the day, they will require something. So I'm sure that since every village today has a primary school center which has at least the facility of having a desktop or a laptop, they can actually go and access whatever it is that you're sending, if at all you can send it through pen drive. So you will have to think of different ways. And I think here it'll be difficult for me to offer a solution which would fit all purposes. You will have to look at what are the kind of students, where are they really located, where you are facing these problems, and then you can pick up one of these three: television, radio, or sending it on pen drives.
Right, that's very interesting. So I have one last question that we will be taking. So COVID-19 has given an opportunity for teachers to become global educators now. Although there has been significant amount of job cuts, they on the other front, there are equal amount of opportunities that have come up because of the online education. So what can you suggest to K-12 teachers who are watching this right now? How can they possibly build a brand, individual brand, and leverage that brand and, you know, build a business online? What can they possibly do to do that?
Communicate. That is one. And by communicate, I don't mean that you continue doing the same of more of the same that you're doing right now. This is also the time for teachers to build their competence and a domain. So, for example, if you look at, while introducing, you said that my domain is negotiation and communication. And therefore, I try to build my domain and my expertise in this. And I try to take every opportunity that comes my way, which means I teach negotiation. I make sure that I do consultancies on negotiation. And I'm also a practicing negotiator. So if at all there are two parties who have a dispute, I play the role of a mediator. I do third party arbitration. I help some companies negotiate with their trade unions. I have also done some complex negotiations. I also advise certain companies or even the governments on how to negotiate. So therefore, what the K-12 teachers can also do is that this is a time when they can actually define their domains for themselves, that this is what I want to be an expert in, and then make sure that they try to upgrade themselves, they try to upskill themselves in that particular domain, one. And second, they communicate through all possible forms. So for example, this is one of the good ways. We are having a webinar and we are having a fireside kind of chat. So likewise, the teachers can engage in a fireside chat with a bunch of students, with their peer group, or with, let's say, experts from the industry, and they can build their network with diverse groups. What the teachers need to do, and this is something very similar to what people even in the corporate world do, is to build networks. And this is where many of us actually fail. So we try to use the social media, but we use the social media for multiple, for reasons for which it is not bent. So for example, and by no means am I saying that don't use social media for fun, by all means. But if you're also looking at a professional development, at least use social media for your professional development where it is meant to be used for professional developments. For example, a platform like LinkedIn or a platform like Twitter is actually meant to engage in a discussion or to disseminate your learning or your experiences in life. So use social media, build your networks, make sure that you are a part of a community where you can actually engage with each other, and while having fun, you are learning from each other. And most importantly, find as many opportunities as you possibly can to share what you have, because the more you share, the more you get to learn as well. Because if at all, let's say I have to prepare for something and somebody invites me to talk on a subject that I'm not very comfortable in, I'll make sure that I prepare very, very well. And likewise, if I have declared to the rest of the world that this happens to be my domain, I will make sure that I keep myself updated. I know the latest research. I know the latest things which are happening in that particular field in terms of practice. So, for example, I should be aware as to what are the important international negotiations going on, both in the social world, both in the and in the political world. What are the important inter-country negotiations that are going on? What are the challenges that our country faces in terms of the international negotiations, so on and so forth? And therefore, by actually having a domain, you also give yourself a reason to keep yourself updated in that particular field. So use a combination. Talk about a domain, update yourself, upskill yourself, and make sure that you use as many opportunities as you possibly can to share whatever it is that you have learned or experienced.
Right. That is incredible, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful insights, Dr. Himanshu. It was an incredible session covering several pointers related to mental well-being, spiritual education, teaching online, and the problems associated with it, and leadership in children. I'm sure all the teachers attending this session would take all these pointers and use it in their daily life. Thank you once again for accepting our request to be here and sharing your thoughts with the educator community. By far, I would probably say that this was one of the most interesting sessions that we have conducted, all thanks to you. and it was filled with insights. I think my excitement can be seen here. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, Varun. And it was such a pleasure talking to you. And it was such a pleasure, all the more a matter of delight for me, because I was talking to my peer group of teachers. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Himanshu. Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
So, dear teachers, we will be posting the feedback form on the website, on the YouTube channel. You can fill the feedback form and you can get the latest updates with regards to all our sessions. This was day one of the Educator Conclave that we have ideated. The next session would be on 10th July, and it would feature a professor from IIM Indore. And he would be talking about organizational behavior. His name is Dr. Srinath Jagannathan. So see you at 10th July, same at 4 p.m. and same YouTube channel. Thank you so much for attending. And I hope you have found some value in today's session. Thank you so much. So the feedback form link is pasted on the chat box. You can just fill that and you can get the latest updates. So once again, teachers, please fill the feedback form so that we can reach out to you and we can host all these sessions. So please stay in touch with us. Thank you so much for being a part of today's session and I'm ending today's session. Thank you once again.